I'll give my talk. I will elaborate on our recent research on mapping dark matter in a nearby universe. And we had a perfect setup for this from the previous two invited keynote speakers. It's great talks. I'm not going to even be equal to that. The previous two talks were really about cosmology. I will not talk about cosmology. I will talk about mapping dark matter in a nearby universe. So there's no cosmology involved. I will use a new technique, which is called the radial acceleration relation, the RAR. Actually, it is a technique which was first perceived by Stacy McCaw. And we use in RAR, we plot the two properties, accelerations. On the horizontal axis, we plot the observed matter in stars and galaxies, assuming a certain mass to light ratio. So that's what we call the baryonic mass. So the acceleration due to baryonic material. On the vertical axis, we plot the acceleration due to dynamics, which includes all the dark matter, but of course also the baryonic matter. So here is a plot like that, which is purely based on Newtonian dynamics, right? Newton on the left and our solar system on the right. And actually, our solar system is totally off scale in this plot. It's five orders of magnitude higher accelerations than the type of accelerations we observe in our universe. That's actually another way of saying that our universe is extremely empty. We are really observing very low accelerations, and this is what really is this business. So I will guide you to most of my plots will have this axis, baryonic matter on the horizontal axis, and dynamical matter, observed matter in the along the vertical axis. Well, such a plot has a number of strange properties, and so I want to tell you that so you can understand them a little bit better. One property is, of course, if you plot accelerations, you get as close as possible to physical models. And that's actually very practical. Second is it allows you to compare different sources of data, whether it's rotation curves of spiral galaxies or velocity dispersions in galaxies or lensing results. You can all plot this in the same graph. So that's very practical. So it allows you to compare data from completely different sources. And I will show that at the end. The price to pay is actually that it is a little bit difficult to understand selection effects in these plots. That's always a little bit complex. And that's probably one of the reasons before 2016, no one made these plots. All right, then we go to the next slide. And this is actually the RAR as observed in spiral galaxies from H1 data. Plot has been made by Stacy McCaw, published in 2016. About 2,200 spiral galaxies, for which the H1 rotation curve has been mapped very carefully. You get about 12 points, a dozen of points per galaxy. So in total, there are about 2,700 points in this plot, right? So this is the radial acceleration relation of all H1 mapped spiral galaxies which we know of. And actually, almost 90% of this data has been acquired here around the corner at the Westerberg Radio Telescope. McCaw did used for the estimating the optical matter, the baryonic matter. He used data from an infrared satellite, which was clearly free of dust, much less obscured by dust. Probably one of the best ways we can detect optical light directly. Well, as you can see, this relation is surprisingly tight. It's really quite remarkable. Actually, the errors are completely dominated by the adopted mass to light ratios of the galaxies. And, well, to be honest, this is not new. I mean, this is just another way of presenting the flat rotation curves. And we already knew from the flat rotation curves of spirals that there is a lot of evidence for dark matter. But this is another way of, you know, this is the Newtonian line. And so the deviation from the Newtonian line is actually evidence of dark matter in galaxies, mapped directly. Well, on this plot, there's also projected the prediction from MOND. And I have Milgrom here on the left, one of the masterminds of MOND, also Bob Sanders here at our institute. MOND actually describes this relation pretty accurate. The only caveat is that it has a free parameter in this fit, which is the characteristic acceleration at which the deviation from Newtonian dynamics becomes visible. So MOND is doing quite well, but the caveat that it is a fit. Actually, there is a free parameter involved. Above me, I have Erik Verlinde, who has a similar model, which completely underlying physics. But actually, his prediction is quite much, almost the same, because his typical acceleration, is in his case not a free parameter, but is a CHL divided by 6, so is related to the natural constants. The underlying physics is completely different, right? Although the prediction is very similar, Erik used the holographic principle in physics. And actually, if I say it in one word, it's a very easy way of saying this. He just computes how much bits you can push, how much gravitons you can push to a sphere when you compute the sphere in terms of squared Planck. He works with squared Plancks. And how many bits can you push to a sphere in terms of squared Planck? So it's a complete, actually, it's an information theory. Well, it would be nice if these two considerations, these two models were independent, but they were not. When I saw the first time, I was saying hoorah, but then I looked again at Erik's paper, and he looked at MOND, and he knew what to predict. So these things are not really independent, so you have to be a little bit careful. But in the bottom line is the Bose theories predict a similar relation. There will be deviations, and that's actually where we are looking for. Okay. Then we go to the next slide. Well, we heard a lot about strong lensing this afternoon. We are also using the weak lensing technique to map the dark matter around galaxies. Well, weak lensing is a very subtle thing. It clearly is an effect of general relativity predicted by Einstein, which is called nature in vivo, right? This is nature. And the light from a distant source, distant galaxy, is very slightly deformed on its way towards the observer by an intervening galaxy called a lens. Well, actually, this deformation is only 1%. And so if you want to do this, you have a little problem. If you want to use this technique to understand what deviation of the light pattern has been made on this path to the observer. Moreover, we don't know what the original shape is of the galaxy. So you would say you're completely lost. You're not lost when you do statistics. You have to do statistics, and Henk already pointed this out in different contexts. But you have to get your hands on as much data as you can, as much sky as you can, and that's why we're building Euclid now. But it was also why we were building OmegaCom and the VST camera to do this job. And actually, we started with this about 20 years ago and started to do the data taking in 2012. Actually, that made us a big data expert. We were quite early with preparing ourselves for big data, and it's also why we built AstroWise. So that's why I have also Turing here in the upper right. Oh, he's all over there now. So this is the information universe in vitro. And actually, I think this experiment, on one hand, the nature doing the lensing and the machines, our computers, doing all the computations, is a beautiful crossover of in vitro and in vitro. It's sort of, for me, a source of inspiration of a lot of work I'm doing. Okay, we did the kid survey. We have already mentioned it. It's now, we used the data release with 1,000 square degrees of sky. And I'm going to show you the result. To push quite a lot of buttons now. Yep. So this is the result of our lensing study of weak lensing using the KIT survey. We selected 2,059,000 galaxies, which were supposed to be isolated. Our isolation criterion was no other object within larger than 10% of the mass of the galaxy within 3 megaparsec. So this is the work done by Margot Brouwer. She will be here on Friday. Kyle Oman and myself and a larger team. And the picture on the middle is the picture from the press release, which we issued last year. It shows the RAR. Now, this is Stacy, this is the H1. And this is the RAR from the lensing results. So you can see we go a few orders of magnitude deeper in accelerations. You also can see this little margin here, this gray thing here. This is the reflection of the uncertainty in adopted master light ratios. So already the uncertainty in the master light ratios is larger than the statistical errors. The statistical errors are amazingly small by now. And it's really amazing that we can go all this way, very far out. Mind you, this is M87. I just plot M87 in here just to get a little bit of feeling of the scale. M87 is the largest galaxy. This is at the edges, well, 5 times beyond the edges of spiral galaxies. And here we go in deep space. Well, you can see that in first view, there is an agreement with the prediction of Bose-Mond and anthropic gravity. But if you look carefully, and that's why we're doing these things now with very high statistics, you can see that these points are a little bit above. And if we separate our sample in early types and late type galaxies, you get this plot here. And then you see that the early type galaxies are lying above the line of the RAR, and the late type galaxies are on the line. So these are the early types and these are the late types. This difference is very significant. It's a 5.7 sigma, something like that. And it will be very difficult to explain this in terms of adopted master light ratios. And actually, this difference, such a difference, is at odds with Bose-Mond and anthropic gravity, because that these two theories would not predict, you know, the nature of an object, which should not have any effect on the. Then we go to the next slide and discuss this difference. And one thing which we did not put into the baryonic matter is the circumgalactic hot gaseous halos. The reason is that we are more or less blind to this component. Actually, I observed them myself in the Einstein satellite in the 80s, and we got the first big CD galaxies, so about 80 objects. Since then, the subject has not progressed as much as many other subjects. So the very low surface brightness of the X-ray halos is really a difficulty. And we hope that the Erosito can help a little bit. But it's even not sure yet. The best we know now about hot galactic circumgalactic halos is that a sample published by Babic, 3994 objects, and he finds that typically the baryonic to the dark matter to baryonic ratio is between 10% and 1 and unity, but that's within the disk. And if you go a little bit beyond the disk, like our measurements here, then this is up to 3. So in principle, it's not a bad idea to include hot gaseous halos in this diagram, and that's what I do in the what we do here in this slide here. And if you include the dark matter halos with a stellar mass, with a halo mass which is about that equal to the stellar mass, so unity, then the whole difference is disappeared. That's a little bit a bizarre conclusion, that we by now know the dark matter much better with a better accuracy than we know the baryonic matter. And I think Hank said it in different ways, but it's really bizarre that we are now that far advanced that we know the dark matter distribution very well. And this clearly also the circumgalactic matter dark halos will be an issue also for interpreting the Euclid data. So since I'm running out of time, I will be very short about the simulations. Kai Roman did a lot of simulations and seeing whether we could produce the RAR with from simulated data. In short, the Bahamas don't do very well. And the mice simulations do well, but they have been tuned to, thank you, Bennett. They have been tuned to observational data. So I'm not sure how independent this is. But it shows that if you tune your data, then you can have a fit which is corresponding to what predictions of Landesidium. All right, then I spend my last 3 minutes on dwarf galaxies. Actually, there is a little bit of holy grail on this subject to understand what's going on with dwarf galaxies. And we have seen a lot of papers with individual cases, which most of them turned out to be controversial because there are a lot of issues. If you look at one single dwarf galaxy, either it's you have a problem with inclination correction or it's not guaranteed that the dwarf is spherealized or in a dynamical stable situation. So we are really after, you know, to get a sample of dwarf galaxies which are representative and for which we are sure that we're dealing with dynamically stable objects. And that's a sample which has been acquired by Teftekari and Rinier Pelletier and myself on the Fornax dwarf galaxies. We have a sample of 36. And I will spare the details of the observations, integral field spectrometer, the little areas here is what has been measured. The most important point is the velocity dispersions along the apertures stay constant, which means that we're really dealing with dynamically stable objects, realized objects. So, you know, we have now finally a good sample with dynamically stable objects and with relatively good data. I mean, it's one night per object. So now go to the RAR of these objects. This is the RAR of the dwarf galaxies. First notion is they fit. They are all the RAR, with the exception of three outliers, which I don't think is statistically very significant. Second notion is that the exactly the same sample, also the fundamental plane has been plotted. The fundamental plane, my co-authors are very keen on doing this analysis, and the red points are the dwarf galaxies on the fundamental plane. And they go up here compared to brighter galaxies. And this is the classical statement. Dwarf galaxies have much more dark matter than bright galaxies. This is, again, also visible in this sample, but also on the RAR. For me, this is an eye-opener, right? Because this higher fraction of dark matter in dwarf galaxies is completely consistent with the RAR. So this is another notion that the RAR seems to be very universal. Then, this is my last slide, Bennett. So now my last slide, I plot the three different probes on one. So I overlay them. So we have Stacy's plot here. We have the dwarf galaxies and we have the lensing. Three completely different techniques, observing techniques, completely different instruments. Everything is different. And they show the same RAR. That's really, I find that amazing. The most amazing part of this plot, which was for me another eye-opener in this last piece of research, is here are the dwarf galaxies. But no, this is also, these are also the accelerations of M87, the largest giant ellipticals. In other words, we are looking here on a scale of 100 kiloparsecs of giant elliptical galaxies, and we're looking at the scale of 1 kiloparsec for the dwarf galaxies. So this enters a completely new dimension to the RAR, right? The RAR is completely, appears to be completely scale independent. And I think that is going to be a challenge for Lambda CDM, because in Lambda CDM, all this stuff is really circumstantial, right? You can, I won't now dwell on the different tuning of reionization and feedback, but in, there are no basic principles in Lambda CDM would explain this. Now, this becomes a little, an order of a magnitude larger. Now we know that also the RAR is scale independent. So whatever you lose, a very large thing or a very small thing, whether it's rotating or vialized, you have the same relation. And that's, let me stop here. Thank you, Bernard, for giving me the time. So the answer to the first part is that G bar is really computed on the basis of M over L ratios, assumed M over L ratios. Is actually assume the whole circumgalactic gas around CD galaxies or giant ellipticals, and no hot halos around spirals. That's the only way we get them together. I'm not saying that this is the resolution, but this is the problem we are confronted with. And we really need X-ray observations to really show us the way, because you don't want to say the universe is squared or round on the basis of something which you just assumed. And this is actually one of the problems, and I think this is also going to be one of the problems for you, Peter, though. Hank will certainly know to evaluate the effect of the missing baryonic matter. And the missing baryonic matter is actually, it was on one of his slides. And the missing baryonic matter is actually closely mapping to the hot coronial gas. So yeah, but we want to prove that. So we need X-ray observations for that.
We have to stop here and move the program on, but we should thank Edwin for a very intriguing talk.